I'm going to talk today about batch effects as a continuation of the lecture that I started on Thursday about experimental design and batch effects. So this part is, we will see, connected to the previous one about how to design our experiments. And just to remember some issues that we talked in the last lecture, remembering that one of the main problems when analyzing data from a given experiment is confounding, and because of the presence of systematic errors or bias. For example, can you give me an example given by the design where we can be, when analyzing the data, having a problem of bias or systematic error? Can you remember some of the examples that we talked about last day? No? For example, when selecting the controls.
Putting them all together.
Okay. Or for example, the dropout that we have to take into account when we have a longitudinal study. Or other problems when selecting the controls, what could happen? Yeah, that we can be comparing, being cheating somehow to get associations if we get getting, if we consider controls that are too young, too healthy, we have two separated populations that are not, it's not of interest in practice in a diagnosis situation, would not be realistically representing what the goal of the experiment would be. So these are examples of systematic errors, and because of the identity that they have, the importance that they have in this new omic source, batch effects are also an important source of bias, and we will talk about them today. So, important to know that they are commonly, they have been found, detected in several studies using different omic sources. So, in evaluations of genetic variants, but also, and especially most of the literature that you can find on this topic is about gene and protein expression experiments, but also related to epigenetic modifications, that how can be the quantification of methylation, and also affecting the experiments related to glycomics. And just once again, the problem of confounding is the mixing of sources of variation. You remember from the last lecture that if we have this problem of confounding, we cannot say anymore if we found difference among groups, case control group, for example, in a biomarker of interest, we cannot really say if the difference that we found is due to this biological process of interest or to some technical device. So, the definition of batch effects, that is something that is typically heard in many of the papers concerning omics data, would be that are non-biological systematic errors in the study. And they appear due to practical reasons because of the complexity that these omic experiments are associated to this. Normally, that happens because the number of samples, the number of individuals that can be analyzed in the same, exactly the same experimental conditions is limited. So you remember one rule that I was talking about in the last lecture related to how to design the basic rule, what was it, related to blocking and randomize? Do you remember? Okay, and first, before that, if we can just get rid of this factor, we should do it. So if we could fix and analyze all our samples in the same plate, that would be the first thing to do. If we cannot do it, we should block, and if we cannot block, we should randomize. There are different types of batch effects, so numerous sources can provoke batch effects, and an important distinction that we can consider is the ones that are time fixed, that would be related to the specific conditions when we carry out the experiment, like the plates in the mass spectrometry, the conditions of the freezer, cleaning, also very important instrument recalibration that that can be seen, or platforms in RNA expression, that we will see some results how when people tried to analyze jointly to get power, you want to have a bigger sample size and you want to mix data from different platforms, you can be facing a problem of batch effects. And then we have also time-dependent batch effects. We have talked about that and see examples in the previous lecture. For example, the day of the week when we carry out our experiment can affect, and we can analyze, and if there's confounding, we are seeing the day of the week when did the experiment and not the biological response variable of interest. An important batch effect that is difficult to handle is the long time that samples are stored. It's important, we want to store the samples to do analysis in the future, but we will have a possible batch effect when doing that. So, batch effects, we consider that is a known structure within the experiment. That would mean that the methods that I will present here, we know we have a variable in identification, the batch. So we have to, when we perform our experiment, we have to, equally that we recollect the sex, age, or the biomarker of interest, we have to identify in our database which individuals, which samples come from the same batch, and then we will be able to do something, otherwise will be more difficult. And usually its presence cannot be avoided by maybe controlled, and maybe controlled in two different ways. First, in the design moment, we have seen a bit about that and we will see more, and in the analysis phase. So we have to exploit the structure of the data afterwards to remove or accommodate in our analysis the presence of these batch effects. Always keeping our objectives in mind. So why do we that? To avoid bias, so robustness of the experiment. We want to have obtained comparable results with other studies, and to improve inefficiency. So just to remember, what is the efficiency? When I talk about efficiency, what I'm talking about? It's about
Cost.
Why? It refers to the getting with the minimum number of samples the better result in terms of precision. Okay. So now we are going to see how this is, why this is important, and in fact, before 2010, there was a number of studies were affected by batch effects. And in the moment of the publication, that was not known. But after that, a research community has thought about that. And now there's a number of papers reviewing this. I will give you, then, when I upload the slides, the complete literature. But for example, this is an interesting paper. It's in Nature Reviews, where they discuss most of the things that I will present here refer to this paper. They revisit some publications and quantify and discuss the presence of batch effects. So a quite famous example is a paper that was published in 2004 about bladder cancer data. So that was a case control study, and they were interested in studying if there were different patterns in gene expression among patients that presented surrounding carcinoma in situ and those that not presented that. They perform hierarchical cluster analysis. You know what is that technique? That means, can someone explain me briefly what do you do with, what's the general idea of this cluster analysis? Just in general.
It's like a tree, so clustering methods, so they can group like.
And do you use in that case the case control status, your response or not?
Oh no, you don't. You see if it will cluster into
cases. Yeah, that's the idea. It's an unsupervised technique, so you would only use the gene expression values of the patients, and you would see if what your tree gives you is related, or it's what you get is a separation in terms of your condition of interest. And in a first moment, it looked that it was like that, the hierarchical cluster analysis could separate between the presence or absence of this surrounding carcinoma in situ. However, what happened? That the presence of this was strongly confounded with the processing date. So they had a time-dependent batch effect. So how can we see this, for example? For example, this is just 8 individuals. Yes, and 8 genes. So we have that each of these lines represents an individual, and each point is the level that was measured in a gene. And we can see here how these 4 genes were analyzed in batch two, and this in batch one. And we can see what we are detecting here is not the case control status, but the fact of the batch. So this is dangerous and was after that discussed after the publication of this paper. Another example would be one that is, well, I took it from a paper from 2007, and it's also a microarray experiment on case control study, and here we present a heat map, so it's represented for individual and 628 genes, the expression of these genes. And the colors means that genes that are overexpressed would be the red ones, and those that are down expressed, that would be the blue one. And here we have, well, the corresponding cluster analysis that we can do by individual or by genes, that the interpretation would be that genes that change together or are co-expressed, and here those individuals that present according to these 628 genes common patterns. And we have several labels. No? Here we have the 12 individuals, and we have this column represent the 3 batches. We have 3 possible batches, so we see numbers from 1 to 3. So this blue you cannot see, but they are all 2s. And here we have the case control status. And what we see is that, again, we have a cluster in terms of the batch 2. So this is interesting, because that would be the first thing to do when exploring our data, to see informally and a quick seat, but we see that there's a batch effect.
There you know what the batch corresponds to, if it's the plate or the time?
Yes, well, that depends in your design. I mean, when you recollect your data, you have to get that information and create variables that represent that. You could have, in fact, several variables representing different aspects of the batch effect. A batch effect is a concept that summarizes technical variation that is not biological, so that you are not you want to remove it and separate it from what you can get. Okay, so as I said, two ways of addressing the batch effects, and first I'm going to talk about a bit the design that you also saw a bit in the previous lecture. So once again, for example, the importance of balance blocking. See, if we have a study to compare a molecular profile in tumor samples versus healthy individuals, the two types of samples should be equally distributed between multiple laboratories and processing times. For example, that would, I think, answer your question. We would have two variables that would represent kind of batch effect. And with this balance blocking, what we are doing is minimizing the probability of confounding. But note that that would not eliminate the presence of batch effects. But most of the methods, to my knowledge, require that you have a balance block design or close to it for being able to correct. Otherwise, you just can through your data, because you are in this situation where the statistician would be the post-mortem analysis, but you could not recover the distinguishing in between among variability source. So this is a simulated scenario. It's interesting to do this simulated studies according to your data. For example, here, that corresponds to a data set that I could work with it for this summer school. And we have 176 individuals, and 88 R cases and 88 R controls. So what I'm doing in this experiment, I'm assuming the same plate structure, so I have three plates, as is the case in my real data, and I am going to check what is the impact in terms of power of different designs. So I generate data. What does it mean? I cannot do that with my data at hand because I don't know the real batch effect, but I can generate it. Of course, this is partially, or this, all the simulation studies are partially, because you are relying your analysis in some initial conditions that you fix beforehand, and when you do simulations, it's very important to report, to explain very well which are those assumptions, to see then, when you have a real data at hand, if it's realistic to assume that you are in a situation close to the one that you simulated. So, how I generate? I generate a continuous outcome that would be, I would be in a situation, for example, where I want to check if a glycan or a gene expression, a gene, is differentially expressed, that would be the gene expression, between cases and controls. So then I have a effect, a main effect of the case control status that is my interest. So what I'm going to see is what is the power that I have to detect that I have an effect. That would depend on the true effect, but also in the noise and in the design. So I want to see that. And then I assume that I have batch effects. And I assume two different scenarios. One that is simpler, maybe unrealistic or realistic, depending on the real data, and one more complicated multiplicative batch effect. So the additive batch effect means that for each plate I have a bias, so the level of my gene of expression or my glycan is shift, depending on the plate that, on the plate that I am, but the variance is the same in all the plates. All the plates has the same calibration error than each other. But I can complicate that and assume that I have a shift because of the plate, but also that the third plate I obtain a much more variable data that can also happen. And of course, this is a simplification because the pattern distribution, I'm assuming only one gene. So if I have thousands of genes, I can have different patterns for different genes. Well, but still, that can give you some clues of the impact of the design on the power. Well, and I have, this would be this optimal situation where there would be no plate effect because in case that is possible, I would put all my samples here, so I would just eliminate that source of variation because there would not exist, completely blocked, and two different levels of confounding. So you can see the confounded by what I represent here is the case control in each plate. So in plate one, here I have 26 cases and 18 controls. And here, in the most extreme situation that I'm studying, I have, so why, can someone ask me why this is, why the name, why the heavy batch confounded level? How can you see that there's a high level of confounding? Yeah, so here, so most of the cases are in the first plate, and most of the controls are the controls are basically in plate two and plate three. So here, that will be, this is also very important for detecting if you have batch effects. These are called interaction plots, and here, well, can someone explain me this plot, for example? So each line, each color represents one plate, and here is the mean value of my marker of interest. So what do you see here? You, for example.
So the mean variance is cool, but the third one, that is the middle
version. No, just here.
Ah, okay.
Ah, sorry, I didn't tell you. This is the situation of perfect blocking, and this is the heavy confounding situation.
Ah, okay. So in this one we don't have the interaction. So
here we have a heavy interaction. Yeah. That would be difficult to interpret what's going on, no? Because we see here how, in fact, the case, because of the bad design, has a lower level of the marker of interest than in the control group, but that is an effect of the design. And here we can see in terms of the effect size, so here I'm representing different values of this main effect, that is my interest, and I represent the power, the ability, the number of times about over 1,000 experiments that I do, of detecting something that is statistically significant higher than one, than zero. So the black line is the situation where I don't have a plate effect. The red is the situation where I have a block design and, as I said, an additive batch effect, so my errors are the same by plate. Green would be the mild confounded situation, and blue the heavy situation. And here we can see how very dangerous, this is very dangerous because in the case we can get false positive discovery. So even in the case where there's no an effect, because of the wrongly allocation and the errors by plate, we can wrongly detect an association that is not there. And then we have a power problem. So I have less ability, so only in a 40% of the situations I'm able to detect a difference when it's there. Okay, and for the multiplicative effects, we can see how here in the simpler situation, if we have a block design, I'm more or less safe, but not when I have a multiplicative situation, where even if I do blocking, I have problems in terms of power. Well, we have already commented that, so very important that when we have unbalanced designs, we cannot know in which situation in terms of our biological effect of interest we are.
Can I ask you a question about the graphs?
Yes.
Because if I understand correctly, on the vertical axis you have power. So if you look at the black line,
yes,
you have no power to detect no effect.
Yes. Well, power is not correct to say in that case, because you don't take off, you don't talk about power when you are in the null case. That is a proportion of rejections is the correct word that should appear there. So that's what you want. In fact, what you want is that in zero is 0.05, because that's your significance level. So I put power, but well, really it should be a proportion of rejections. Okay, because power is in the situation where are you in the alternative. There's an effect. If there's no effect, you don't talk about power. Okay, so, well, so analysis phase. Now we have our data, so that was just to say how important is to design. But now we have our data, that's it. We cannot change how we design our analysis. And we want to see what is there. So first, we would have to do an exploratory analysis to detect and quantify the batch effects. We can do that graphically or really numerically quantifying that. We already saw some of these graphical possibilities with the interaction plots. We also can represent with box plots by, that would be for, imagine, just focus here, our variable of interest is this first position for glycons, and we have one box plot for each of the batches. So we can see that is the same variable, but we have different levels in the median. So the ideal situation would be that we would not observe that, and more or less these median values in the box plot would be the same by batch. Here, for example, we also can wonder ourselves, you think that here there's a batch effect, what we are representing is genome locations and vertically the sample is ordered by date. So do you see any pattern, any clustering of the intensity of the signal according to this processing date? Where? In which part? In the middle, here. In this part, we see that informally we can see that there's a important, probably important batch effect. But we cannot give a, we can see that it's there, but we cannot see how much, how important it is, how strong it is. Another way of do graphical diagnosis, a bit between, we will also use it for quantified, but also graphically, is using principal component analysis that you have already heard about it. And the idea is that with principal component analysis, we just estimate the most common patterns that across that exist in the features in our variables, in our gene expression dataset, or in our glycans, etc. Again, like in the hierarchical clustering, we don't use the outcome. We would just look to our matrix of variables of interest, of gene expression, etc. So it's a dimension reduction technique, because we would go from a set of values that are of correlated variables into a set of values of uncorrelated linearly variables. So with the linearly, we have to be aware that this is a limitation of principal component analysis. If the correlation is not linear but from other nature, well, we could have a problem. It's an assumption of these techniques. And the idea is that we will have less principal components than original variables, and that these principal components will be ordered by the amount of variability of the data that they contain. So the first principal component is the direction, the variable, that contains most, that explains most of the variability on the data, and subsequently like that. How are we going to use this for detecting or have an idea of batch effects? We will see if these principal components relate to the batches. We don't use the, for calculating the principal components, we just use the data. So after that, we can see, okay, these principal components that I obtain are related, are reflecting somehow the batch effects. Then I have a problem. For example, and that happens. That can happen. Here we see two examples where two data sets with potentially presence of batch effects. Here the batch effect, I think, is represented by different platforms, and we see how this is very clear batch effect. We represent the first principal component against the second one, and we have a very different patterns according to the batch effect. And also here, a bit less, but we also see a clearly pattern according to batch effects. Okay, then we can quantify how, by using regression models and giving, for example, or the number of features that are associated with the batch, that would be a way, or, for example, giving a quantification of the level of confounding. We can do a regression, linear model or a logistic model, depending on the nature of our outcome, and using the batch variable, the batch indicator, as a covariate, and give the R square, the level of explained variance for that variable. That would give us information, a number, on the level of batch. And we could do an equivalent thing by using as an outcome the principal component. That would be a multivariate way, because that I would do it, well, with the outcome is a general thing, but if I do a regression with every of my gene expression values and the batch, I have a univariate approach that can differ, and using the principal component, I would use that as a summary of my whole information on the features. This is, again, in this very interesting paper, they did a systematic review of different studies and they quantified the level of confounding using these different techniques. For example, here we present, there are more in their paper, here we just choose five of these studies, and we have a different batch effects given by different issues. For example, that would be what you have to record, the date, if the date is a potential batch effect. The processing group, that is like more abstract, there should be a protocol indicating what that means. Well, and could be other, like a platform, but here I don't have that other example. So here we have a number that represents the percentage of confounding. What I'm doing here, I'm using as response of a regression model the outcome, and using as covariate the batch variable, indicator variable, and providing the level of explained variable. So we can see how is the maximum value would be 100, and we see how there's evidence of confounding according to this approach. We can see it in a different way by counting the number of features that are affected by batch effects. What would it mean? I have 1,000 features, 1,000 gene expressions, and I can do univariant analysis regression with the batch variable, and do a test, like an AF test, if I'm using an ANOVA variable, and see if the p-value that I obtain is below 0.05, and count how many of the 1,000 features result significant. Would be that correct? Such like I have explained that. I have 1,000 features, I do 1,000 F-test, T-test, whatever test, and then I say, okay, 10% is significant. Would be that correct? By? Correction, what do you mean?
If you have multiple testing.
Okay, yeah, that's the... You have... Tell me.
So if you have multiple testing, then you can get error in finding the correct p-value, so you would have to do correction of erroneous.
Okay, yeah, perfect. That's the idea. The idea is good, but previously reporting that number, you have to correct your p-values for the fact that you have multiple comparisons. So another approach, use the principal components. See how of the which of the principal components is the most highly associated to the batch effects. Here they report the order, so is the that means that the first principal component was the one that presented a highest association with the batch, and that association was more than a 50%. So alternative ways of explaining the same, giving us an idea that should have a consistent result. So useful in practice when you have your data to analyze it. And just about the downstream consequences, we know that from the day before yesterday, the increased variability and the decreased power, but there are other more subtle consequences that can be of great importance, that the batch effects may affect the correlation among the variables. And these correlations among variables are used in a number of methods for analyzing data. For example, which are the gene-gene interactions matrix more than the correlation between genes? Maybe does gene-gene interaction matrix are affected by the batch effects, and then we are adding error, or we can have the problem of arriving to wrong conclusions by using this. So, now we know that it's important to be aware of the fact of having batch effects or not, quantifying, and now we would like to correct them. So, basically, there are quite a big literature on methods that have been proposed, but most of them of limited use. I will give a reference where you can see a comparison of these methods. Basically, what has been done along the years, it has been, well, univariate methods, we would consider one feature at a time, or multivariate methods. Data normalization, we will see what that means, or regression-based. So, I put data normalization as a method because it has been used or thought that they can be a method for correcting five batch, but it's not true. In general, normalization steps do not remove the batch effects. So what is normalization? In general, it refers to the transformation that is made to make the features comparable. So it's typically done to, once that you have your data from the machine, to transform your data so that each feature has the same mean and the same variance. That is helpful for some steps of the analysis, but that doesn't mean that you don't have batch effects anymore. Why? Because the batch effects affects a specific subset of genes and may affect different genes in different ways. And in fact, sometimes this normalization approach can even show more clearly the batch effect that without normalizing, you don't see it. A way of correcting by batch effects would be use a regression approach. We could do a regression on the future using the batch as outcome and take the residuals for the downstream analysis. And here we can see the impact, again, in our simulated scenarios of doing such a simple correction on the power. So here we can see how in the additive effect with the mild, the green would be like I have some confounding, but it's still, let's say, okay, we can, so the increase in power is noticeable. And also in the heavy case, but still you see how we cannot reach to the level of the other designs. And the same for the multiplicative batch effects. We can see that even in the block design, well, we improve, but we cannot get the situation where the batch are not present. So in principle, this shows that doing correction is, in general, the correct way to act. More sophisticated multivariate methods for correcting by batch effects are also there. I present this because it's older than the one that is considered the state of art nowadays. Maybe the oldest, I'm not completely sure, but maybe it was one of the first proposals on this field. And the idea is, again, using the principal component analysis, and would be to filter out those principal components that represent the experimental artifact. So we would do our singular value decomposition to detect the principal components, and we would identify the eigenvectors, so the principal components that represent the batch effects by their association with the batch effect. And we would set this, the corresponding, each eigenvector has an eigenvalue associated by this single value decomposition, and we would set the batch effect eigenvalue to zero. Yeah.
How can we identify these eigenvectors that represent batch effect?
Doing principal component analysis.
Yeah. How do you know which one?
Which one is the by correlation, but what we did before. You have to calculate what is the principal component that is most associated with the batch effect, as we saw before, and then you would assume that that is your eigenvector of batch effects, and then you act there.
But let's say in an extreme case where you have all the cases on one plate and all the controls on the other, your effect and your batch.
Yeah, well, of course, yeah. Well, so I don't, yes.
Let's say those eigenvectors are not.
Yeah. Well, I think I said it before, but yes, what you are assuming here is that you have a well-designed experiment. If you have that situation, you cannot do it. That's clear. Yeah, I don't know. I think but yes, that's of course very important.
Because that assumes that you know what cases and controls are, whereas if you, I don't know, know, not design an experiment for a specific outcome, but you measure several things.
You have to, or have already residuals on that, controlling by that. And moreover, you have to, well, the problem of that is, well, there are many problems with this approach. That's why I don't think it's that commonly used. It's highly dependent on this selection of the, of course, in my opinion, I would not advise to use this method at all. And moreover, it requires sample size. It's not really doable for small experiments. And moreover, apart from the fact that, and related to the fact that you are eliminating the variation due to a principal component, and you can be eliminating also variance that is biological, is of interest. Okay? So it's complicated. And, well, an alternative that we could consider that is the state of art nowadays is to fit a location scale model with shrinkage. This model would result familiar now because is, for example, how I generated my data corresponds with this type of general model. So in principle, you are, of course, assuming a structure of your data, but quite flexible. And you will do shrinkage in the sense that you would, so the expression, the expected value of a gene would help to predict the expected value of genes that are close to it. So you are kind of using information from your agency matrix to improve your estimates. And that is useful because, in fact, when they proposed this approach, one of the advantages and the novelty of this approach is that it works for small sample sizes. Well, and these are the important is that it's implemented in R in a SVA package. And even if, this is still a field that is in progress, this is a paper that I told you that is interesting. There's comparative studies suggest that is the preferable among the existing multivariate methods. So this paper in PLOS One, they compare the previous approach that I mentioned based on singular variate decomposition and other related approaches, but relying in the same idea. And it seems that that this combat method performs better. So here we can see the example that I presented at the beginning with a batch effect that would be before correction and after correction. We can see how this pattern disappears. So that's all. The conclusions would be that in the design phase it's important that we are aware already about the problems that we can have if we have batch effects, so it should be taken into account in the design of the experiment, especially because if the case control status is not separable from the batch effects, we are just lost. And we could see it in practice, we will see it in our research project. That